Good morning, and what a great day to be alive. Welcome to favornetwork.net, to the Mount Hermon Missionary Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Oscar T. Moses. I serve as the senior pastor here at Mount Hermon, located at 7848 South Normal in Chicago, on the South Side. We are the Progressional Church. That is, we are the traditional church with the progressive members, membership, and message. Every Sunday morning, a message of hope is preached from the Mount Hermon Baptist Church. It is our prayer that if you are unsaved, that through this telecast, that you would come to know Jesus Christ. Once again, welcome to Favor Network. Bring in your scattering thoughts and let's enter into worship. God bless you.
And just tell the Lord, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
thank you, Lord.
Yes, God.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, thank you, Lord. God. Thank you, God.
For the many times I've fallen, yet you forgave me. Thank you, Lord. I thank you for unmerited favor and your brand new mercy. Thank you. How I thank you for waking me up this morning, for letting me see one more dawning.
For me,
thank you.
Lord, that's all I say
thank you.
See, you allow me to see another day.
Thank
you. Oh, no goodness of my own.
Thank
but it was by your mercy. It was by your grace. It was by your love. It was by your faith. Lord, I thank you.
Thank
when I think of the goodness of Jesus. And all that he's done for me,
thank
my soul cries hallelujah.
Thank
Lord, thank you for saving me.
Thank
when I couldn't see my way through.
Thank you.
Good morning, and what a great day to be alive. Welcome to favornetwork.net, to the Mount Hermon Missionary Baptist Church. I'm Pastor Oscar T. Moses. I serve as the senior pastor here at Mount Hermon, located at 7848 South Normal in Chicago, on the South Side. We are the Progressional Church. That is, we are the traditional church with the progressive members, membership, and message. Every Sunday morning, a message of hope is preached from the Mount Hermon Baptist Church. It is our prayer that if you are unsaved, that through this telecast, that you would come to know Jesus Christ. Once again, welcome to Favor Network. Bring in your scattering thoughts and let's enter into worship. God bless you.
And just tell the Lord, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes, God. Thank you, God.
For the many times I've fallen, yet you forgave me. Thank you. Lord, I thank you for unmerited favor and your brand new mercy. Tom, it just wouldn't be enough.
done so much for me.
Thanks.
Lord, that's all I could say.
Thank you.
See, you allowed me to see another day.
Thanks.
Oh, no goodness of my own.
Thanks.
But it was by your mercy. It was by your grace. It Thanks. Was by your love. It was by your faith. Lord, I thank you.
Thanks.
When I think of the goodness of Jesus.
Thanks.
And all that he's done for me.
Thanks.
My soul cries hallelujah.
Thanks.
Lord, thank you for saving me.
Thanks.
When I couldn't see my way through.
Thank you.
You kept making a way out of no way.
Thank you.
For the Lord is my shepherd.
Thank you.
Sanctuary. I know there's at least three things you can think about that the Lord has been good to you and that you're thankful about. Just look at somebody and say, I am thankful. So thankful. Let's bring in our scattering thoughts now as we prepare for the Lord's Prayer. Let's put our hands together, give the Lord a hand praise. Before you take your seat, grab a neighbor by the hand, bring them down to the altar. It is the hour of prayer. Tell your neighbor it's prayer time. Son of God, disclosing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and your heads bowed and your eyes closed.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Heavenly Father, we come before you with bowed heads and humble hearts to give thanks, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being a good God. Thank you, Lord, although we show ourselves as filthy rags. We want to thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us. Thank you for bringing us from November 2012 to November 2013. Lord, we haven't done everything that we should have done, but Lord, we're striving to do better. Lord, I stand here also as an intercessor for those that cannot pray for themselves, for those that don't want to pray, and for those that just won't do. Lord, I thank you. I thank you for my family. My family is a riot, Lord, but I know you can fix it, Lord. I thank you for everything that you've done, Lord. It's been a hard year, Lord, but I thank you because you've been a mighty God, and a mighty God I love, Lord. You're omnipotent, you're almighty, Lord, and I thank you. As, Lord, we are going to our conclusion for this anniversary, Lord, thank you for those that have been faithful to this church. Thank you for everything that they've done. Thank you for the things that we should be doing, Lord. Look over our city, Lord. It's gone awry. Lord, I don't know what's happening, but we have not done your will. We're doing our will, and our will is not what you want us to do. Lord, we just want to thank you. I can't just stop it, Lord. I can't just thank you. I'm just so happy, Lord. But these things I ask in your name. And Lord, when we leave this place, give us traveling grace. Take us back to our home. Take us back to our nest of safety. And Lord, let us keep you in our prayers. These blessings I ask in your name. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. As you go back thank to you, that Lord. Seat, shake three people's hand. Tell them, I believe that everything's going to be all right. Come on,
thank
encourage
you,
somebody
Lord.
Today.
Thank
somebody
you.
Needs encouraging today. Thank you.
power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power.
Come on.
In the name of Jesus.
Come on, you declare it.
There is power. There is power.
There is power
in the name.
In the name of Jesus.
We know where it is to break,
break every chain.
Break every chain.
Come on, say it to me.
Break every chain. Break every chain.
Break every chain.
There's an army rising. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up, yeah. To break every chain, break every chain.
Praise God. Praise God. I don't know what the pastor is going to preach on this morning, but I'm already filled with the Holy Spirit. I am already on fire for Jesus. We came in this place thanking God for everything he's done for us. We sang praises to God. We woke up with a praise on our tongue. That song this morning said, I have 1,000 tongues. I'd never be able to praise God enough. I'd never be able to thank him enough. for creating a financial situation out of no financial situation, for putting food on tables that have no food on tables. Hallelujah, God. I thank you, God. I thank you, God, for having me in a warm place on a cold day. I thank you, God, for everything that you do in my life. Then we turned right around and said, break every chain, Father God. Break every chain, Father God. Break every chain, Father God. Hallelujah, in this place today. There is power. There is power. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in this place. I thank you, God. We have some visitors here today. And I know by now you welcome. I know you welcome by now. I guess you just want to hear your name, so I'm going to say it. Joanne Mack. Joanne Mack, are you here? Where you at, Joanne? Stand up, Joanne. Yes, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. We thank God for you, Joanne, this morning. We ask God to break every chain off your life that's bothering you. Every burden in your life right now, we pray that you will be changed when you leave here today. We thank you for visiting with us today. Along with Joanne, we have April McDonald. Where's April? Bless your heart. April, thank you so much. Thank you so much, April, for being here with us this morning. We ask God that you bless April and her situation right now as well. Do we have any other visitors with us this morning? Anyone here for their first time, second time, anytime? Well, right now, we like to thank everyone. We like to welcome the Father. Thank you, Father. God bless you. God bless you. We welcome the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit in everyone's life today. We thank you for coming to church this morning. We thank you for coming here to get fueled up just a little bit more for the rest of this week. We ask that you take what you get here this morning from this great man of God, Pastor O.T. Moses, and take it out into your life, Father God. We ask that you take it to your job. Take it into your families. Take it back home to that person that you left at home this morning, Father. We ask that you are blessed. We ask that you come back and visit with us once again. You might have forgot something. You might want some more. We will be here every single Sunday. Every time the door is open, it's on our bulletin, and we ask that you come out and join with us. God bless you. Mount Hermon, let's greet each other in our fellowship way.
Come on, Mount Hermon, some of us haven't seen each other all week long. Never again will we have the same assembly. Let us fellowship. Let us fellowship.
Oh, what a fellowship, what a joy divinely laid on. What a blessedness, oh, what peace of mind laid on. The everlasting on, oh, I'm leaning, oh, leaning. Safe and secure from all alarm. Holy, leaning on the everlasting. I'm leaning on Jesus Christ, my Savior, safe and secure from all alarm. I'm leaning on Jesus Christ, my Savior, leaning on the everlasting. Oh, I'm leaning, oh, leaning, and secure from all alarms. Leaning, oh, leaning, leaning on the everlasting. Oh, I'm leaning, oh, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning, oh, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arm. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand of praise.
heartaches and pain will soon be over. There'll be no more. All be over. Just stay alive and walk. I've never been told. I'm gonna build that host in white. Traveling all day and night. I'm gonna walk in that old Jerusalem. I'm gonna walk in that old Jerusalem. Where the half has never been told. Where the half has never been told. And we will rise. Oh, what a happy day it will be. I'm not perfect. I don't want to be perfect. But he keep it. I wasn't going to come this morning, Pastor. I was going through something. But I said, I'm going to get on it. Through the cold.
Bye.
And bye.
Today, I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives. I serve a risen Savior that's in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives. I serve a risen Savior that's in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives. Jesus, Christ Jesus, he walks with me and he talks with me along the narrow way. He lives. Salvation. You ask me how I know he lives. I serve a risen Savior that's in this world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy, I hear his voice of cheer. You ask me how I know he lives. Jesus, Christ Jesus, he walks with me and he talks with me along the narrow way. He lives. Salvation. You ask me how I know he lives. 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 Put your hands together if you know he lives. Praise him like you wanna if you know he lives. He's been better to you than you've been to yourself. You ought to bless him.
standing all over the sanctuary. Thank God he lives within my heart. Amen. Anybody happy that he lives within me? I don't know how you feel about it, but my Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord. You know, wherever you go, no matter what you do, don't ever stop saying amen. That's the language of the church. You know you're around some church folk when you hear amen. I said, aren't you glad that he lives within our heart? I just need a few folk that's happy about him living. Just a few. You all gonna let me preach this, all right? Because my Bible says that the person has subject to the Spirit.
Yeah.
And so the Spirit can't take you that far where you can't listen to the preach word. Amen. So let's bring ourselves together, because you have not worshiped until you've heard a word from the Lord. We've been conditioned by society to believe that there is power in numbers. But is there really power in numbers? We often sometimes feel that we have power when we have a lot of friends. Sometimes the majority is wrong, and people side with the majority. And if you're not careful, you'll start to think that the number of friends you befriend on Facebook, or the number of people that you have connected with on Twitter, or the people you have locked into on LinkedIn, you'll start to think that they give you some sense of prestige, power, or autonomy. But for the Christian, you got to be careful when you start depending on people and not depending on God. When you shift your faith in the number of people and take your faith off of God, then you put God not in his proper place. And so the question is there really power in numbers? I believe that God wants to do something great through Mount Hermon.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But it won't be through a lot of people. It'll just be through a few people, James.
Yeah.
Through a few people. And so today I want you to bow your head and I pray that we will learn that the people you connect with does not necessarily give you power. Listen to what I'm saying. The people you connect with do not necessarily give you power. It's the God you connect to that gives you power. So I would that you would bow your head, close your eyes, ask the Lord to give you what you need on today from his word. Eternal God, our Father, we come right now humbly obeying your will. Lord, we recognize we have fallen short of your glory. And so right now, we ask that you would forgive us of all of our sins. Create within us a clean heart and renew the right spirit within us. Holy Spirit, it's your time. Rescue us from us. Speak to our hearts, minds, and soul, that we might leave here challenged by your word and better Christians when we leave than we were before we became. God, we want to stop right now and give you glory, honor, and praise. It's in the strong name of Jesus Christ. We count it all joy through faith. And all of those who love the Lord said amen.
Amen.
Are we ready? Aim, fire. This is my Bible. There are many like it, but this one is mine. It is my weapon. It is my roadmap in enemy country. In my Bible is found the plan of salvation. Romans 10 and 9 says that thou shalt confess with thy mouth Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. It is by my humility towards our Christ, hospitality within our congregation, hard work within our community, that the unsaved will be won to Christ. I would that you would turn right back to the book of Judges, where we've been for the past 3 weeks. Judges chapter 7, that's wrong, I wrote that wrong. It's Judges chapter 7, amen. Look at somebody and say Judges chapter 7.
Judges chapter 7.
And it's verses 15 through 23. It's a quite lengthy text, but allow me to read verses 15 through 22, and then we'll read 23 together. Reading from the King James Version, you'll find the word of God reads on this wise. And it was so, when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and the interpretation thereof, he worshipped and returned into the host of Israel and said, arise, for the Lord hath delivered into your hand the host of the Midian. He divided the 300 men into three companies, and he put a trumpet in every man's hand, with empty pitchers and lamps within the pitchers. And he said unto them, look on me, and do likewise. And behold, when I come to the outside of the camp, it shall be that as I do, so shall ye do. When I blow with the trumpet, And I, all that are with me, then blow ye the trumpets also on every side of all the camp, and say the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. So Gideon and the 300 men that were with him came unto the outside of the camp in the beginning of the middle watch, and they had but newly set the watch, and they blew the trumpets, and they brake the pitchers that were in their hands. And the three companies blew the trumpets, and brake the pitchers, and held the lamps in their left hands, and the trumpets in their right hands to blow withal. And they cried, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And they stood every man in his place round about the camp. And all the hosts ran and cried and fled, and the 300 blew the trumpets. And the Lord set every man's sword against his fellow, even throughout all the hosts. And the hosts fled to Bethshittera and to Zerizath. You know, I'm not right pronouncing those right. And the Lord of Ambalamarah and Taba, let's read together. And the men of Israel gathered themselves together out of Naphtali, and out of Asher, and out of Manasseh, and pursued after the Midianites. Amen. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand. Grab a neighbor by the hand, look them in the eye, and say, neighbor,
neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor,
it's good to see you.
Good to see you alive.
Good to see you in church.
Today's lesson,
experiencing
the power of God,
part three. Keep holding their hand and saying,
experiencing
the power of God
among
powerless people.
You may be seated in the presence of God.
Let me try to walk through this real quick and then give you some points that we could glean for today. This is part three of a series entitled Experiencing the Power of God. In the previous two lessons, first lesson we learned about experiencing God in a powerless place. The Midianites had literally led the children of Israel into a state of constant fear. So much so that they were hiding in caves and hiding in dens. They were trying to grab whatever sustenance or seed they could to protect it from the enemy destroying their seed. And I said on that Sunday and last Sunday how very important it is to protect the seed that you need. Let me say it one more time, because I believe that there's strength in repetition. You ought to be careful who you sit next to, because everyone that you sit next to, they don't always feel the need to protect the seed. The seed is, in fact, the word of God. And so let me say it again, for repetition is good for pedagogy. You ought to be careful who you sit next to, because you don't know what that person might be going through, but you know what you need, and you know that you need the seed of God's word in order to make it through. So we talked about experiencing God in a powerless place. And we concluded that when you experience God in a powerless place, then we must do what the children of Israel did, and that is they cried unto the Lord. Lesson two was experiencing God with a powerless personal perspective. There are times when we feel powerless within ourselves, as Gideon did, when the Lord came to him with that assignment and said, Gideon, thou mighty man of valor. Gideon did not, in fact, feel like what God called him. But God saw what he could be long before he was what he should be. And so we learned in last week's lesson that whenever you find yourself in a powerless personal perspective, to use what you got. Every Christian has something that the world does not have, and that is the benefit of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will comfort us. The Holy Spirit will correct us. The Holy Spirit will give us confidence, and the Holy Spirit will give us courage and counsel. And so on last week, we left Gideon. Gideon has just been told by the Lord that he would be a mighty man of valor. He assures Gideon that as you go, I will be with you. But Gideon still was not convinced. And at least three times he goes to the Lord and he asks the Lord, he says, give me a sign to show me that you are with me. And I would not suggest today, brothers and sisters, that you challenge God, that you tempt God, but you simply have to rest on what the Word of God says. After three challenges of God, God finally convinces Gideon that he will be with him, that God, in fact, would be with Gideon as one man that will literally defeat the Midian army. He tells Gideon, what I want you to do before we go forward is that I want you to tear down these altars, these false gods of Asherah, these gods of Baal. And Gideon was a little fearful to do that because everyone in the community worshiped these false gods. So he does it at nighttime because he's scared of the people. But when they discover that the altars are torn down and they discover that Gideon is in fact the culprit, they seek to take Gideon's life. But his father, Joash, steps forward and says, wait a minute. He says, if Baal is a god, then let Baal fight for himself. If Baal is your god, then don't jump Gideon. If Gideon was wrong, let Baal fight for himself. It was there that Gideon received the name Jerubbaal, Baal, let Baal contend. That simply means that since Gideon had tore down that altar, if Baal was God, then Baal should have did something. But Baal did not do anything. And after that point, the people begin to come over and believe in Gideon's assignment. As a matter of fact, Gideon had confidence. He had influence in the people because now they see that the Lord is with Gideon. I'm going to be through in a little while. Just walk with me for a little while. And so by the time we get to chapter 7, tap your neighbor and say, by the time we get to chapter 7, Gideon's name is now Jerubbaal. Jerubbaal, which means let Baal contend. Gideon now gets his army. He grabs the people that are going to fight with him against the Midianites. Don't miss this. Midianites, the army is 135,000 soldiers. Gideon grabs a ragtime army of 32,000. Don't miss that. Gideon has an army of 32,000. And he's going after an army of 135,000. Gideon gets his army together. And when they get ready, he gets ready to give instruction. Verse 2, God says, hold up, Gideon. He says, you've got too many in your army. He said, wait a minute. I got 32,000. But the Midianites got 135,000. God said, I know that. You got too many. Huh? You mean tell me that I've got too many? We're already at a disadvantage. The Midianites have taken us, had us living in a constant state of fear. You told me you were going to be with me, Lord, and now you've given me an army. Now you're telling me that I got too much? He said, I'll tell you what I want you to do, Gideon. He says, go down to your army, and you say to the army, if any of you all are scared, go home. And that day, 22,000 left Gideon's army. Now, if you know how to add or subtract, you do understand at this point that Gideon's army has been reduced now from 32,000 to 10,000. Because 22,000 said, see ya. Arrivederci, I'll holler at you, deuces. I'm not going out like that. If I'm going to die, let me die on a significant cross. This is not important to me. And so I'm going back home with my mama now. I'll be all right there. 10,000 left. Gideon's feeling pretty good, but not as good as he could if he had
at least what the army of the Midians had. God says, Gideon, Gideon, you still got too many. Gideon said, wait a minute. All I have left is 10,000 against their 135,000. Lord says, Gideon, this is what I want you to do. He says, take the men and take them all down by the river. And he says, and then I'll show you what to do. When they get down to the riverside, Josephus, the Jewish historian, says that it was the heat of the day. And so Gideon takes them down there when it's hot and the heat is turned up and they're in fact thirsty. And so Gideon knows, or the Lord knows, that they're going to want to drink some water when they get down to the riverside. And so when the 10,000 get down there, there were 300 men that lacked the water like a dog. And there were 9,700 men that got down on their knees and grabbed the water and drank it until they got filled. Gideon says, I want you to take those 9,700, put them on that side, and take the 300 and put them on that side. He said, now with the 9,700, go get their trumpets, go get all of their warfare, get all of their stuff, and send them home. But this 300 right here, Gideon, that's all I'm going to give you. And these 300 men are going to lead you to victory. Now, no doubt Gideon is asking, Lord, why did you take all of those men away from me? When he go back up to verse 2, the Lord tells Gideon, he says, if I let them win with 32,000, they'll think that they got the power. Don't miss this. But if I take away 22,000, if I take away 9,700 and only 300, then they'll know that they don't have the power. I've got the power. See, Gideon, I don't want you to think, God help me, that there's power in numbers, because they can't do nothing unless I put my power in them. I don't want you to think that no matter how big it is, I don't care if it's an army of 3,000, I don't care if it's an army of 30,000, I don't care if it's an army of 3. If I want to use those 3 people to do what 30,000 can do, it's my power, I do what I want to do. Watch what happens in the text. God tells Gideon, take these 3 men. Go over this war strategy. A.F. Muir says that Gideon's war strategy is one of the most marvelous mysteries of antiquity. You've never seen a war strategy quite like Gideon's. Gideon says, this is what I want you to do. He says, before I do that, the Lord told Gideon, Gideon, you still seem a little bit shaky. So let me, don't miss this, he said, let me give you some inspiration so you can turn around and give the people some inspiration. He said, this is what I want you to do, Gideon. He says, I want you to go at nighttime. Go down, sneak down, spy into the Midianites' camp. And the Midianites were down there, and they numbered the field. Gideon had strategized his army above the mountains. The Midianites were in the valley. He said, I want you to go down there. He said, if you're scared, take your servant Purah with you, and he'll go down there with you. I'm gonna let you hear something that will give you some inspiration. And so Gideon sneaks down there, and when he gets down there, he hears two Midianite soldiers over talking, and he hears their conversation. And one of them said, I had a dream last night that a baked loaf of barley bread just rolled into the tent and just demolished the whole tent and turned the tent over. And the other one said, that was Gideon. He said, I believe that that's Gideon, and I believe that the Lord is going to allow Gideon to take over the army of the Midianites. Gideon hears that. He gets inspired. He said, well, thank you, Lord. He worships the Lord right there. If you read the text, when he hears about the victory, he starts to worship the Lord. He goes back up to the mountains. Now that he's inspired, then he has to inspire the people, and he tells them, arise. Now, this is what I want you to do. I'm going to give you a jar. I'm going to give you a lamp. I'm going to give you a trumpet. He said, you put that trumpet in your left hand, and you put that large jar and lamp, light, in the right hand. He said, and whatever I do, you do. If you don't see me do it, don't you do it. But whatever I do, that's what you do. And so Gideon divides the army up into groups of 100, three companies. And he says, when I go down, I want you to go down. He says, you wait for my signal. And what they did is that while the enemy was down sleeping, it was the middle watch of the night. It was midnight, about midnight, and they were down there sleeping. They were unsuspecting. There's only 300 men in Gideon's army. There's 135,000 men in the valley. Gideon says, what I want you to do is I want you to set a company on that side. I want you to set a company on that side. We'll be right here, and we'll leave the north exit open when they get ready to run. He said, what I want you to do, he said, when you hear me blow my horn, I want you to blow your horn. He said, when you see me smash my jaw, you smash your jaw. Now, what I want you to do is I want you to put a little light inside that jaw. Put a little light. Tell somebody, put a little light inside the jaw. He says, I'm going to blow the trumpet. And then when I blow my trumpet, I'm going to smash my jaw. And my light is going to shine. And when Gideon blew his horn, every man had to be in position where Gideon had assigned them. And when Gideon blows his horn and smashes his trumpet, all of them blow their horn at the same time and smash their trumpet. And when the Midianites look up, all they see is lights surrounded. And Gideon say, when you smash your trumpet, I want to hear you shout, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And when they smashed those jars, blew those trumpets, they all said in a loud voice, the sword of the Lord and Gideon. And when those Midianites heard that shout, when they heard that trumpet, when they saw them lights, they thought that this army of 300 was possibly an army of 300,000. And the Bible says, watch this, when they did, when God inspired Gideon, Gideon inspired the people. And the people did as Gideon instructed, as Gideon did as God instructed. And when he smashed the jars, and when the light shone, God said, now let me take over. God woke the enemy up. They drew their swords out. And the text says, I didn't make it up, the text says that God directed their swords on one another. Can I stop right there and say, you ought to let God fight your battles? You think that you can handle it, but God will make your enemy your footstool. He'll make your enemy turn on one another. Have I got any help in here? Watch what happens in the text. There's three movements in the text, and I'm going to get out your way this morning, I promise. I'm going to get it. There are three things that I want you to understand in this text, because when after they turn their swords on one another, the enemy starts running. And then the army of Israel starts to chase them. And one writer said some of the folk that went home came back. Ain't that just like black folk? Because you do know these black folk. As soon as you start winning, then here come the team again. Three movements in this text. First of all, I want you to understand that Gideon understood or learned something about the powerlessness of the congregation. Help me say that. The powerlessness of the congregation. God told Gideon, your army is too big, and if you let this army win, then they'll think they won the battle instead of me. And so there are three types of people in Gideon's army, and there are three types of people in here today. Can I show it to you? First of all, there was the fearful. Those were the ones that said, I can't hang with this Gideon. I don't want no parts of the battle. Perhaps they had little faith that God would deliver them from the 135,000. Whatever the reason was, they caused their fear to leave the army. And unfortunately, we got to come to grips. Tell somebody, we got to come to grips with the fact that people do leave the church for different reasons. Often it's masked with criticism of what they do not like, but in most cases, they don't want to face the battle. They were under the misunderstanding that being a church member meant just showing up. and not engaging in the battle. Not engaging in, unfortunately, that's when they dropped out of God's army. There's the fearful, then there's the feeble. God told Gideon, the army is still too big. Take them down to the river, and I'll make the final cut. The ones I give you, you go with the rest of them, let them go. And he had the 300 dog lappers, and all the rest knelt to drink. Now, the text does not say, but we can imply that the dog lappers, they were the ones that were lapping water, looking out for the enemy at the same time. They were down at the river, but they knew that the enemy had some devilish tactics. And the devil likes to sneak up on you. And so when they were down at the water, you know, they didn't take their eyes off the enemy. But they lapped water, and they was looking for the enemy. And I want to suggest this morning on my way to heaven, because heaven is my goal, that you've got to learn how to watch and pray. You've got to be mindful that the enemy comes in many shapes, different sizes. And as a matter of fact, the enemy can dress up in a costume that looks like your best friend. You've got to be careful to keep your eyes on God for the enemy. And then you had these other group of fellas, Chuck, that just, they knelt on their knees. They were just drinking until they got full. Never did look up. A little bit careless. They were a little bit shaky. They wasn't stable. A little bit, they wanted to be a part of a great movement of God, but they couldn't be relied upon, because they were never looking out for the enemy. They wanted to be a part of, they're subject to walk off the battlefield when the heat is turned up. But God has a way of showing Gideon who will be the feeble and who will be the fable. God wants his affairs to be put in the hands of faithful people. I'm gonna say something that y'all ain't gonna like, but there comes a time when we've got to stop putting God's business in the hands of people that don't have a relationship with God. People say, you just let, no, you can't let everybody do everything. You can't let everybody do. How you going to handle kingdom business when you don't have a relationship with the king? Amen. When it comes down to assigning people to do God's work, we got to stop making people a priority who make God an afterthought. Preach, O.T. Moses. You got three groups of people here. You got fearful folk, you've got feeble folk, they're shaky, not stable. Then you have the faithful. In verse 7, God says, I will use 300 men who lap at the stream to save you and give Midian into your hands. All the rest can go home. Now imagination suggests that they lapped water and kept their eyes on the enemy. This could possibly mean that they were conscious of attacks. The same applies to the faithful of the church. They become aware of the tricks of the enemy and become watchful in prayer. Here it is. The congregation has no power, no matter how large the membership may be. God can use a church of 30 people to do as much as a church with 3,000 people. He uses those who are willing to be faithful. And often the number of the faithful are few. Now, here's another movement in the text. Because the text talks about inspiration. God gave Gideon inspiration. And when he told him to go down and spy, and he heard about the victory. After Gideon gets inspiration, he comes back to give the people. Are you all with me? He comes back to give the people inspiration. This is when Gideon is inspired to go forward. However, he needed to be inspired if he was going to inspire the people. That's why sometimes I don't answer my phone when you call me on certain days. Or you see my car in front of the church, I won't answer the phone. Don't take it personal. Tell somebody, don't take it personal. I'm just trying to get my inspiration. Because I realize that if I don't get no inspiration, can't no preacher inspire somebody else if they're not first inspired themselves. The preacher must be inspired if he's going to preach God's word. That's why there has to be some preparation. And if there's some inspiration, no inspiration in the preparation, then Sunday morning would be a devastation. There got to be some inspiration for the leader if the leader is going to inspire the people. So God inspires Gideon. Gideon turns around, inspires the people. But the third movement in this text is power of cooperation. Look at somebody and say cooperation. Gideon had a strategy. He organized the 300 into three companies. He gave each man a trumpet and an empty jar with a torch in the jar. In verse 17, Gideon said, "Watch me. Do what I do. When I get to the edge of the camp, do exactly what I do. When I and those that are with me blow their trumpets, you do the same thing. And all around the camp, blow your trumpets and shout for God and for Gideon." Everybody had an assignment, and they did it. Can I stop right here and say that when the church is in cooperation, God can do great things through a few people that are willing to cooperate. You can't have cooperation if the pastor say, "Are we all right? We all going this way?" And somebody else said, "No, let's go this way." That's not cooperation. Amen. 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 And amen. I preached these three sermons to you with intention. I preached these three sermons on experiencing the power of God to inspire this congregation, to enlarge our territory for ministry. I've tried to inspire you that God's power is not limited. It's our thinking that's limited. I've tried to tell you that if God wants Mount Hermon to build a new church, buy a new church, renovate a church, to expand ministry and provide resources to Auburn, Gresham, Chicago, California, or Cuba, no majority of haters, procrastinators, or instigators can stop God from doing what he wants to do. When the leader is in cooperation with God and the people, God help me, are in cooperation with God's leader, powerful things happen. Amen. 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 Listen, we're moving into a new year, the year of consideration, where we must explore options to expand our ministry. And already people are murmuring, "Why do you want to do that? What do you want to do about that? Why you want to go there? I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that." I'm aware that everybody will not always line up with pastoral leadership coming out of the gate. I know that. But for the few people that are faithful and recognize the tricks of Satan and lessons about a few faithful soldiers that understand that when God gets ready to do something powerful, everybody will not be on board. And some that appear to be on board, they're not on board. They talk a good game. I'm going to preach this whether y'all like it or not. And they fool the masses. But there is a twistedness. Ooh, y'all ain't going to like this. There's a twistedness about their faith. There's a perversion about their faith that talks good with one mouth, but do little manipulative things to pull people away behind the scenes. You think I don't know who you are, but I know who you are. Yes, I'm his too. God does not want us to focus on people that leave, but to focus on people that remain. Because with God's power, numbers are insignificant. You could be a one-man army all by yourself. Without God's power, efforts are insufficient and outcomes are impotent. Here's the question. What do you do? What do you do when you don't have much to work with? What do you do when the people you thought you needed walked away from you? I know y'all ain't gonna like this. What do you do when the numbers are not on your side? When the chips are down and the force seems to be far? What do you do when you seem powerless? What do you do when it seems like you have no power to go on? What do you do when you find yourself in a powerless place with a powerless personal perspective? What do you do? And don't think that everybody that walks out of your life, boo, don't think that. Don't think that you needed everybody that walked out of your life. Don't think that everyone that walks out of your life is a burden. Sometimes it's a blessing. Some people may not be good for what God is trying to do for your life right then. That's why you got to make sure you are connected to the right power source. When God's power kicks in, it does not matter who walks away from you. You and God are the majority. When God's power kicks in, when you're in a powerless place, have a powerless personal perspective, and when you are among powers, your hookup is like a backup generator when your battery runs low. So some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about, but I got some folk in here that understand that when your power runs low, then you know how to get the hookup. You know how to plug into the power source. You realize that there's power in prayer. It's just like when my cell phone goes dead, it needs power. I got to plug it up to the power source. I need about 15 folk that don't mind waving your hand and say, when I get low, that's when I plug into my power source in prayer. I don't know how you, I really can close right here by telling you that there's power in prayer. Listen, I may be feeling weak before prayer, but if I get down and have a little talk with Jesus, I feel better if I can tell him all about my trouble. Tell somebody you got to have the right connection. And let me be clear. Some people are connected with the church and not to God. I'm trying to help you. Come to church. You may pay your tithes and offerings. You may even sing in the choir. You may preach in the pulpit every Sunday. But you're just doing church, not ministry. There's a difference from being connected to the church and being connected with God. First of all, you got to make sure you got the right connection. Tell somebody you got to have the right connection. I'm about to close. Better tell somebody, just let God be God. After Gideon, after the 22,000 walked away, and after 10,000 walked away, Gideon was left with only 300 men. Yet great things happen when you let God be God. I've seen some people come, and I've seen people go, and I've discovered that great things happen when you just let God be God. Gideon did what the Lord told him to do. And the people did what Gideon instructed them to do. They took their trumpets, their lamps, and their jars. And they began to march up and surround the enemy. They did not have the power of the Midianites. But powerful things happen when you just let God be God. Gideon said, when I give the command, every man blow your trumpet in cooperation and smash the jars. And I want everybody to shout a sword of God. And for Gideon, when Gideon did what God told him to do, and the people that followed him did what Gideon instructed him to do, that's when God said, let me take over. And when you watch the text, you'll discover that God literally says, just let me do what I can do all by myself. And verse 22 says that God he aimed the sword of the soldiers that were on the battlefield, one with another. And I ought to stop right here and tell somebody, if you just let God, if you just let God be God, he can handle your enemy. If I had one witness here today that don't mind grabbing that neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, I've made up my mind. I've got my heart fixed. I've got my heart fixed. I've got my mind made up that I don't care how you feel about it. But I made up in my mind. I'm just gonna let God. I'm gonna let God be God. Is there anybody in here that don't mind waving your hands and say, when I turned it over to the Lord, I found out how great he is. Is there anybody in here that's ever had a powerless situation? Is there anybody in here that ever had people walk away from you and you turn to the Lord in prayer? And when you discovered that God was all you had, you discovered that God was all you need. I've got to get out of here now. Would help me close it out. Grab someone else by the hand and say, neighbor, neighbor, I know a man that's from Galilee. When I was in trouble, he set me free. Son of David, seed of Abraham, stone you out of a mountain, meek and humble lamb. I may not have a lot of friends on Facebook. I may not have a following on my Twitter account, but I have discovered that if God is for me, who can be against me? I've discovered that me and God is the majority. Is there anybody in here that don't mind waving your hands and say, I thank the Lord for showing up in my life. I've got to close here now. But I'm reminded of what the songwriter says. Without God, I can do nothing. Without God, I would surely fail. Without God, my life would be drifted like a ship without a sail. Anybody in here gotta thank the Lord for being your guide? Anybody in here that can thank the Lord for his power? You don't hear me. Anybody in here don't mind praising the Lord and say, I thank God that on a hill called Calvary, he dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder and the power. You don't hear me. The power. Early Sunday morning, he got up with all power. All power. All power. All power. All power. Say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. I'm through preaching. I'm just celebrating about his power. I don't have none, but I thank God that he's got all power in his hands. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Can you say yeah? Yeah! Yeah! Ah, yeah! Yeah! Yeah, yeah! Yeah, yeah! Yeah, yeah! I thank God for your Holy Spirit. I thank you for showing up. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Yeah! Yeah!
Hallelujah. The spirits and the power of God among powerless people. It's something about numbers, Pastor. He used 300 to fight a battle that they didn't even have to raise a finger. 100% God. 100% the Son. 100% the Holy Spirit was all there with them. You too can get to know the power of God, even in the midst of your hopeless situation, even in the midst of those things that seem to be causing you to be powerless. You can obtain the same power that we have in Christ Jesus. Will you give your life unto Him today? All you gotta do is just give yourself to Him, because God will take care of you. Will there be one today?
Give yourself to Jesus.
You don't have much time.
You don't have much time.
Give yourself. Of safety for the last 90 days. You can restore your relationship back with Christ on today. You don't have to leave here the same way that you came, but you can give yourself unto Christ. Just give us 1 second, sweetheart. Will there be one? Your life so bright.
He'll make your life so bright.
Ooh.
Give yourself to Jesus.
He's waiting just for you. Your trust.
Just put all your trust in Him.
God.
God will take care of you.
Lord God, we come now thanking you for your word that has gone forth to sound and brass. We know that your word will accomplish that you purpose, and it would not return unto you void. Thank you now, Master, for using a man of God in such a powerful way to deliver such a power-packed message. All we have to do is just trust in you. And lean not unto thy own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge you, and you will direct our paths. Lord God, there may be some men, some woman, some boy, some girl, under the very sound of my voice that knows you not. We pray, oh God, that you will prick their hearts even now, that they may come making the decision, giving their lives unto you, that they can have an intimate relationship with you, that their lives will be changed and go out and tell others about you, that they may be able to come to know you as well. Lord God, there may be someone watching over the internet waves. We ask that you would just touch them right now. Keep them in your care. Grant them all yet another opportunity to give their lives unto you. And we'll be so careful to give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor. It's in the mighty and matchless Son, Jesus' name, we pray and ask it all. Amen. Amen.
Thank God for the visitation of the Holy Spirit. We certainly pray that the word on today empowered you, encouraged you, and enlightened you. It is our prayer that you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 10:9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Our doors are open. Our address is 7848 South Normal here on the south side of Chicago. Our phone number is area code 773-874-3510. Or you can contact us by email. Our email address is Herman, H-E-R-M-O-N, at Ameritech, that's ameritech.net. Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, we offer our Christian Growth Academy. And every Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, we have the Hour of Power, a power-packed prayer meeting. Once again, we thank you for tuning in to www.favornetwork.net. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday morning. God bless you.